Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show is brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Great new inventory. Ford, Lincoln, Kia. Sunbury Motors also has Hyundai. That great, great warranty. Maybe your budget says pre-owned inventory. They have the best selection of pre-owned inventory anywhere. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Ryan Snyder in a few moments, but first, our play-by-play call of the day.
Clears it to center ice where Shattenkirk is there to intercept and sweep it back in. Korpisalo connects with Savard around the far side. Not out. Kucherov in front. Point! Score! Score! Braden Point again! And the Lightning win it! They win the series! They win game five! 5-4 in overtime!
Wow.
Dave Mishkin, as only Dave could call an overtime game winner, joined by the voice of reason, Phil Esposito, at the end there. Dave, he's passionate. You love the passion. And they avenged last year's loss to Columbus in the opening round by winning the opening round this time in five games. Flyers lost last night, still up 3-2. Tampa Bay leads the Yankees, bottom of the eighth inning, 8-5. The Phillies have already lost game one of a doubleheader to Toronto, 3-2. NBA, Houston leads Oklahoma City 35-30 at the end of the first quarter. Houston up a game to none. Miami beat Indiana earlier today, 109-100, and the Heat now lead the series 2-0. All right. The effect of recruiting. Now, see, you know, we heard Dave Mishkin. It wasn't like we were listening to Ricky Ricardo, who's the Spanish language voice of the Yankees, so he's working right now. He's also the Spanish language voice of the Eagles. We think Ricky is brilliant. We've had him on the show, and he's been not just a good guest, an awesome guest. Another awesome guest is Ryan Snyder from Rivals.com and Blue White Illustrated. Ryan, great to have you with us, as always, on the show.
Oh. Learned something else today about who the Yankees announcer is now. Thank you, Steve.
Spanish language.
Spanish language, sorry.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. John Sterling's still there.
What's going on?
Well, he said to me, I remember we're doing the pinstripe poll. I'll give you John Sterling's booth. This is great. Is it pointed toward the field? Yeah. All right. So
I remember seeing you in the booth. I was, yeah. We were like, I guess next to you guys, just looking right over. It was kind of reminded me of the Spikes booth, but a lot bigger. But never mind. Go on.
Yeah. No, it was. And except it was, you know, behind the goalpost. So, I mean, I could see the extra points really good.
Yeah, that was nice.
Any takes from you from what James Franklin said today?
You know, I didn't get to watch the whole thing. Nate was watching, taking care of most of it. I was doing a recruiting call with a parent at the time. But, you know, pretty much what I expected, right? I mean, it's unfortunate. They had great plans in place. Those plans appeared to be working, and then the rug got pulled out from underneath them. So I think James made that clear. He's made that clear, obviously, for the, you know, past week or so now in different ways. But, you know, it's pretty much what I expected. I think fans still praying and having their fingers crossed that there will be a Big Ten season in the fall is pretty much just that. It's, you know, you can do is cross your fingers, but I don't see it happening. But, you know, aside from that, I just hope they get this 12-hour thing figured out. James was pretty vocal about that. He didn't like that. And, you know, he had a lot of good things to say about how, you know, a lot of other conferences have their hand in that, and it's not fair to the Big Ten and the Pac-12 teams, especially those that didn't really want this decision. So we'll see what comes with that. But most importantly, I just hope they figure out what to do here in the winter or the spring, because a lot of people, including myself, my own company, and others, yourself included, would love to see some football here at some point. It's kind of needed in some ways.
Yeah, no doubt. All right, so in talking with various recruits, obviously, this doesn't affect their clock in any way, but does it affect their perception of what's going on?
Not yet. You know, I think if games actually take place elsewhere, and especially if the NCAA does roll back the dead period, maybe like in November, I'd be surprised if it happened in October, but if they did do it at the end and recruits could, you know, maybe go to an Iron Bowl or something like that, I think it would maybe impact some things. But for the most part, no. Recruits still understand that Penn State is a Goliath in the college football world. Same with Ohio State, Michigan. You know, I would be curious to see, and I don't have a good enough feel for it just because I focus on Penn State, but maybe if some guys who are looking at the Purdues of the world or maybe a little more interested in, you know, the Wake Forest or the Vanderbilts of the world, you know, that kind of level of a mid-tier FBS kind of recruit, just because of, you know, there's always the perception that, you know, the SEC just has a bigger following than some of maybe the mid-tier Big Ten schools. But, you know, from Penn State's point of view, no, it really hasn't impacted those guys. I mean, they understand that this is a decision that was out of, you know, at least Franklin and his staff's hands, and, you know, that this really didn't impact them much. And, you know, some of them, I've actually talked to one or two that if everything falls in place with the early enrollments, they kind of like it because they feel like they could maybe get two seasons for one. And I don't think it'll really work out that way, but I've actually heard more of the opposite where it's, you know, kind of like, wow, you know, if I could get there in January, you know, I have the chance to maybe not play that first season, but, you know, really impress on that, on the scout team, and then come fall, maybe make an impact. So I've heard more of the opposite than anything.
Okay. That's interesting. Which then brings it to the next part. We do know that when Clemson played Alabama, the first time Deshaun Watson was a quarterback, and Alabama won the game. Because of when Alabama's spring semester begins, which is a couple of days after New Year's, Jalen Hurts, as a true freshman, was allowed to be at practice and impersonate Deshaun Watson for the championship game. Have you heard anything about the possibility of early enrollees being allowed to play spring football?
Oh, I wish I had that answer. I think James Franklin wishes he had that answer. I think there's a lot of guys that wish they would. Obviously, that's going to get worked out with time. I think a lot of guys are optimistic about that, and they would like for that to be the case. Personally, I just would be surprised if they're not forced to sit that out the first year. Maybe they can scout team, you know, but even that, I'd kind of be surprised. This is what's messed up about it, though. And I think a lot of people that follow recruiting and understand scholarship counts and all that is how does this work then if the ACC and these other conferences don't play in the spring? Because now all of a sudden there's a big discrepancy in numbers. And if I think this is something the Big Ten really kind of didn't think about, and they could maybe hand-tie themselves in some way moving forward. So it's a lot of things got to get worked out. I think Sandy kind of described the other day that she's on committees that are working to figure some of that stuff out.
Yep.
But it feels like to me this is some pretty complicated stuff. Or not? Maybe not. Maybe I'm overthinking a little bit. But you know, she was mentioning, you know, maybe a week or two that we could have some answers, not all of them, but even some.
And concepts.
To me, I hope they don't rush it either, because it felt like the decision to cancel it was rushed. And, you know, this next decision is monumental in so many ways. One thing I'll add, though, is I would be really surprised if they would hurt or impact seniors, you know, coming into college. I mean, to me, you know, these guys have already put in the credits, have already pretty much finished, you know, their high school careers. You know, to then say, oh, well, you guys can't come early, you got to wait till June. Well, then what do they do for 4, 5, 6 months at home? You know, to me, that would – I'd be very surprised if, you know, they said, hey, no, you can't come and start taking college credit on a scholarship too. But, you know, maybe it's some kind of auxiliary scholarship for a couple months and they don't count against football. It's just – there's so many questions there. And hopefully we'll get the answer soon. But, again, I hesitate. Just hopefully they don't make it too soon and they really think it all out.
Who have you been in contact with? What kind of reads are you getting?
As far as 2022, 2021, a little bit of everything, I assume?
A little bit of everything.
Well, 2021 is, again, it's going to be a smaller class. So it's down to, I don't know, 4 or 5 scholarships. Well, maybe a little more than that. I think today it kind of projects as like an 18, 19. And, you know, there's so many unanswered questions there, too, with so many little seniors. But we're looking, I guess, or I'm paying attention to Diego Pounds, who's an offensive lineman out of North Carolina. Mm-hmm. He's been leaning towards Penn State for a little while now, or at least we believe so. Although North Carolina did offer him recently, and anyone that's followed recruiting knows that Matt Brown and staff are pretty hot right now. So that's curious to watch. But that's also an in-state school who ignored this young man for a while and then tried to come in late and steal him away. So we'll see what happens. He's kind of waiting, holding off. You know, there's another player, of course, Nolan Rucci and Derek Davis, the two Pennsylvania prospects. Both kind of seem to have their heels dug in and don't seem to be in a rush. With that said, you know, I get the impression that maybe Rucci would make a decision before Davis. And that's mainly just because, you know, I think his family, of course, Todd, his father is a Penn State alum and, you know, knows college football and played in the NFL. He understands at least, I think, the dead periods and the way college recruiting calendars work. And it feels like, you know, visits aren't coming anytime soon. They've been to Wisconsin enough. His brother plays for Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. They've been to Penn State enough where they can maybe make this decision here. I don't want to say this month, but maybe next. We'll see. It's just tough to say. I get the impression they're closer, at least, than Derek Davis. The good thing with Derek Davis is that we feel pretty good that Penn State's in the lead right now. Don't want to rule out Ohio State or LSU and some other good schools. But he would be a major pool that Penn State needs to get him. So 2021 can end with a pretty good splash, but there's just so many kids out there who are really just undecided. Like, I feel like they really want to make a move right now, but they're just scared to, if that makes sense.
What is the dead period, this extended dead period, done for decision-making by young people?
Yeah, scared them because they don't want to be the one that makes a decision. And then a month later, because this, let me clarify, this dead period has been rolled over every month. So yeah, this last one was rolled over on August 11th or 12th, I believe, and now it runs until September. And it'll probably be the same again next time. So we'll learn about October around September 11th, 12th, somewhere in that range. And so with it being a rolling calendar, I guess you want to say, whatever you want to call it, these guys are hesitant to be the one who makes a decision this month and then look silly when the following month you are allowed to take visits then, and you know, they want to open things up again and take those trips. So it's just forced a lot of players who already wanted to make decisions either during their season or late in the summer to just hit the brakes and wait as long as possible. Now, what I think will be very interesting with that is if we get a flood of decommitments at the end too, it could really mix some things up. But, you know, to me, I guess I'm torn on one thing, because the dead period, it feels like during the NCAA's last announcement, you know, they admitted that the coaches don't want visits right now. And that's something I've been kind of hitting on for a little while now. And it's simple, because the coaches need to focus on their players the most. And it makes sense. The coaches or the players were gone for a couple months. They just got them back. You know, now that that's changing in the Big 12 and the Pac-12, and if it were to change down south, could they potentially open it up then to recruits? Because recruits won't be interacting with current players. It'll be, you know, a bit more safer, I guess, because you don't have the worry of impacting a college football season that, you know, is making billions of dollars. So I'm curious to see November. That's kind of the month I have circled right now.
Sure.
You know, they'll get through early September and try and play maybe, and because of that, they'll force the dead period back. But if something were to happen and those other conferences don't play, I think it actually helps recruits potentially get on campus because, again, they're worried about a kid flying in from Arizona to Penn State, getting everybody sick, and then, you know, that costs Fox and ABC and all these teams, you know, money when they have to cancel these games.
All right. When you look at Penn State's current list of verbals, you and I both know that when somebody verbals, James is adamant with them, this is your decision. Okay? Are you sure? Doesn't mean it's going to be steadfast and in the end always work as we know. But he really harps hard on, are you sure? When you look at Penn State's verbals, do you feel like that it is a solid commitment group in terms of, yeah, when you've talked to them, you don't see any waiver in them?
No, I really do. Of course, now I say that, there will be somebody who backs out.
Sure,
here.
I understand, but in general.
But I really do. You know, the guy I think a lot of people were maybe wondering about was Jalen Reed, defensive back out of Detroit. And that was just earlier on, Michigan State was really making a hard push there. And, you know, people up in that region, you know, kept kind of suggesting that, you know, if the dead period opens up, he'll be interested in taking a visit. Well, you know, months have gone on then. Since then, of course, you know, it feels like, from what I understand, there's less talk there between Michigan State and Reed. And Reed publicly has said, obviously, nothing but the right thing. You know, he's actually been adamant on Twitter in recent weeks about, like, people need to knock that talk off. So we'll see. I mean, it comes from a you know, legit sources, I guess you would say. I mean, there was certainly some interest from Michigan State, and from everything I've been told, there, you know, was interest on both sides. But he said all the right things, and I have no reason to question him. What I will say is, now there's a bunch of 2022 commitments in recent weeks. You know, a few of those players, Holden Stace, hasn't been able to visit. You know, just something to keep an eye on down the road. But Stace, I will, to counteract that, you know, he has a really good relationship with Bowen. I think Bowen has been kind of the MVP on this.
He's one of the stars in recruiting. He's no getting around it. He's definitely one of them. There are many, but he's one of them.
Yeah. You know, I always kind of say, at least when people ask me that, you know, Snyder has the harder job, you know, trying to pull in kids from Florida up to Penn State. But, you know, the tentacles that Bowen has spread throughout D.C. and Baltimore have really given Penn State an in so many schools.
Yeah.
But we'll see. I mean, again, I want to give him credit with that Stace commitment, because on Rivals, we have him as a three-star right now. And I think Thomas, he's been doing a good job on our film breakdowns, would tell you he's a heck of a player and
right.
Pretty underranked right now. So we'll see if we can get him moved up in the coming months.
Very quickly here, there are new coaches in the conference, like Greg Schiano at Rutgers, Mel Tucker at Michigan State, second year from Mike Loxley. Have they made inroads, or has this been a roadblock for them?
Definitely a roadblock. You know, Loxley's doing okay. Loxley's always been a good recruiter.
Yeah.
But again, you know, that face-to-face interaction, especially with Maryland, who's really put money into facilities.
I've seen them. Yep.
Yeah, they're legit. What was the old arena called there?
Cole Fieldhouse.
Yeah, I mean, that's a heck of a facility now. They put a really good money into that. You know, Schiano, again, he has that first year, you know, head coach excitement. You know, he's going to pull in guys. And if you look at the rating, Rutgers is actually pretty good. I mean, I believe they're top 25. But if you also understand the ratings, they have a lot of players committed, a lot of, you know, three-star kids. And I don't want to talk down on three-stars. I mean, there's going to be
some kids
in that group that really go on.
You can accumulate a lot of points if you're getting verbals early, because the points add up. I know what you're talking
about.
Exactly.
Yeah. So they'll probably finish, you know, upper second half, which is really good for Rutgers. Let's call it what it is. I mean, they're doing a good job there. But it's always like that with that first year, second year. You know, you get that bump. You get that excitement, but then you got to prove it on the field. And Maryland's really, they're in the crosshairs this year, you know, because of that. You know, they landed some great players last year. Rakeem Jarrett, of course, the five-star wide receiver. You know, now they have to produce, so that'll be interesting. With Mel Tucker, I mean, it's kind of the same with Michigan State. You know, they always get those underrated guys from the, you know, Midwest, Michigan, yeah, a couple areas who kind of go under the radar with scouting, and then, you know, the difference is, you know, D'Antonio was always able to kind of produce them. Will Tucker be able to produce them?
Right.
Only time will really tell. But, I mean, they're all doing an okay job. But make no mistake, I mean, having this, what were we on now, 5 months of not being able to interact in person.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're a new coach and you're trying to sell yourself and a new program, a new image, not being able to do that in person with all your support staff with you, it makes an impact. And it's hurt Penn State as much as almost anyone. I'll put that out there because of just how good of a recruiter James is, especially with families and friends and coaches and all that.
Well, and that's one of the keys. When you're recruiting at a high level like James Franklin is, when you're going after like high threes, fours, and some fives along the way, and you have the ability to develop them up one or two stars like they have, mm-hmm. See, that's the difference, I think, in the end. Ryan, thank you so much. Appreciate you very much and the great work you do.
Hey, guys, take care. Appreciate you. Take care.
Ryan Snyder, Blue White Illustrated, and Rivals.com. Back with more in a moment. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, great new inventory. Maybe the budget says pre-owned inventory. Can't do any better than Sunbury Motors on pre-owned inventory. Fabulous. Great deals, fabulous sales staff. They think about you. And the service department takes care of the life of the vehicle, all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15, and Hummel's Wharf. Tampa Bay beat the Yankees today, 10-5. The Yankees flag at the Cotrillo Homestead at half-mast.
Yeah, definitely. And here's another thing. Now, listen, I think Aaron Boone has done a nice job for the most part since he's taken over here. But
I would hope you'd say that. He speaks highly of you.
Sense.
He speaks highly of you.
I mean, but this lineup makes zero sense. He's got Mike Tauchman in the 3-hole, then Urshela 4, Gleyber Torres 5, then Estrada, Gardner, Frazier, Kratz, and Wade. Tauchman in the 3-hole, I just don't understand at all. I would be putting Luke Voit in the 3 spot, Urshela 2nd, Torres cleanup, and move Frazier a little more up in the lineup, probably even 5th or 6th at this point. There's no way Tauchman should be 3 and Estrada should be 6 in the lineup. I'm sorry. But that's
you sorry
me.
About the lineup, or are you sorry you said it?
No, I'm sorry about the lineup.
The Phillies lost the opening game of a doubleheader, 7 innings each, to Buffalo 3-2. Game 2 on Eagle 107 is underway. It is scoreless in the top of the first, but the Phillies have runners on first and second. James Harden is 1-for-7 in threes, and Houston's losing. 50-47, 3 minutes ago, first half in Orlando. So there you go. Miami already won over Indiana today, lead the series 2-0. See, part of this, Mark, when I'm working this show, no matter whom I've worked the show with, there are moments where I take on the role of sports psychologist. And you can now tell why, Mark. And you can tell why, Mark. I feel like Dr. Fraser Crane. I'm listening. I'm listening. All right. Great to have you with us on the show today.
they're trying to get everything squared away in the hours that can be utilized during the course of the week for non-participating teams in the fall. Right now they're settled on 12. I think that's wrong. Should be 20. Should be 20. Simple as that. Let them just keep working. They're safer there than anywhere else. You know, when I heard people say that originally, I was like, well, yeah. But then when you realize the protocols, doctors around, trainers around, you've heard about myocarditis and so forth, enlarged hearts. You know, sometimes it's gets caught in a physical. Penn State had two players in that vein 2 years ago in a physical. Georgia State's quarterback is enlarged and infective heart. They say it's from COVID-19. Well, I mean, that's what Hank Gather said. That is, and there's no doubt it's one of the causes. But there's, as I've pointed out several times, there are multiple causes. It doesn't take much to sit there and research it and read it. The SEC is moving along. Georgia, Alabama, Auburn all say they're going to have fans. Not just play the games, they're going to have fans. I mean, we have.
And I just saw from Brett McMurphy today, Steve, that Florida State is going to allow tailgating.
Yeah. I mean, the last time I heard anybody brag about fans, it was the suit, and I was like, yeah. So I said, "Well, show me the fans." And I heard golf applause, like he made a par on 17. I wasn't overwhelmed. Oh my God! We got to work the suit in here from time to time. You got to work them in. The jacket and tie, as he points out, he is the straw that stirs the drink here. You know, even though I prefer mine shaken, not stirred. No, I'm just kidding. You people are awful. This is his big week. This is the Indy 500 week. So let's open up the phone lines and see if we can get the predictions from everybody as to who's going to win. Hello? Hello?
Is this thing on?
Hello? It's our guy. It's our guy. Oh, my goodness. We do need to get his prediction on who's going to win here at some point. I think it would be good for his soul. Don't you think?
We can try to work on that. We can try to make that happen tomorrow.
No, I think it would be good for his soul just to get him on here to predict who's going to win the Indy 500. Now, I will point out there are some advantages for you and me. The last time we asked him to come on and make a prediction, the answer was so long. I actually left and got a bite to eat. Terrific. What? I'm just telling you, there are advantages to this. You don't realize. Happy for Buffalo. They won the first game of their doubleheader. Beat the Phillies. All right. A man with a baseball question. Who is the man? Who do we have? Who has the baseball question? What's your name, please? Where are you calling from? Hey, Dick, how are you, buddy?
Hey, how are you, Steve?
I'm doing well, Dick.
I have a question for you, and obviously I know the Baltimore was playing at the Buffalo yesterday.
Yeah.
I heard you call them the Buffalo Blue Jays. But irrespective of that, you know, obviously there's guys injured in baseball, and you probably have a better handle. Who do you think? Which team do you think in the playoff hunt is most affected by a player that opted out of not playing this season?
In baseball?
Yes. Like in there are guys. There's some superstars, some really good baseball players opted not to play this season. So I'm asking you, which team that has the best chance of making the playoffs is going to be hurt most by their best ball player or one of their best ball players opting out of this season? I know that's maybe a hard way to put it, but you understand my question.
Yeah, I understand your question.
I would say on the surface,
I would say the Dodgers, because you'd like to have David Price in your rotation in a playoff situation where it takes a lot of pressure off everybody else. Plus, David Price has already also shown the willingness to pitch out of the bullpen and doesn't really care about his spot in the rotation in the postseason. So the Dodgers with David Price, because Kenta Maeda, for example, who's now with the Twins, is pitching really, really well. So you don't have Maeda in the rotation. He's with the Twins. And I would say that it would be David Price of the Dodgers.
I mean, I was just curious. I know that guys get injured, and the Yankees obviously have...
Oh, they have a bundle of them.
They go through injuries like whatever, and they usually have somebody that can fill in at a high level. It's just their form system. But I was just... Because I didn't keep track of everybody that said, I'm not playing this season. We had... What was the guy from the Mets that said, I'm just going home? They had to go looking for him. He wasn't anywhere.
Yes, Cespedes. But that's why I guess at the end of the
year when they're getting ready for the playoffs, somebody will say, "Geez, I wish he'd have been in our lineup yet." I guess
I think it's David Price.
Okay.
Because again, when you get into a short series, your starting pitching becomes so important. But then because what Price did in 2018, where he said, "Look, I'll come out of the bullpen, I'll fill in gaps here," he could have done the same thing for the Dodgers, especially with the fact that Maeda was traded to the Twins, so they don't have that additional starter. So I think that's the team I think that would get hurt by an opt-out. Now, the Yankees are hurt if Judge is out for a period of time. I mean, that's going to hurt them. And, you know, those are injuries. But in terms of opt-outs, Price would be the one I would think of right away.
I mean, every once in a while I saw where somebody just decided not to play, but I really just didn't keep track of.
Yeah, well, look at Tuukka Rask.
Who they were, I mean, obviously.
Tuukka Rask, the goalie for the Bruins. Right? Suddenly in the middle of the bubble, it was a family situation. Now, what it is, it has something to do with his daughter, and we don't know anything more than that. That's why he opted out. And he opted out because of the distraction of it.
I was just looking at the scores and they brought the standings up, and I thought, you know, because I see who's you know, in every division who's in first right now, and I thought,
yeah,
you know, come the end of the time, I was just going to say, well, somebody might be hurt down the line by somebody not being there. That was just the only reason I mentioned.
Yeah, and I'm going to stick with that because I think he is. He was acquired along with Mookie Betts for a reason. They acquired Betts for his bat and his defense, his smarts. But also Price is a guy that, after going through a good portion of his career of not being a very good postseason pitcher, developed into a great postseason pitcher that knows how to close now.
Okay. That was just my question for today.
Yeah. Thanks, Dick. Appreciate it. Great to hear from
you. Thanks, Steve. Yeah, bye.
All right. Now, if it's Matt has a series of Yankees that they cannot live without, starting with Gary Sanchez.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
You're just so anti-Sanchez.
Just learn how to block the plate, and I'll be better suited for you.
All we need now is an Indy 500 prediction from the suit.
Yeah, we'll make it happen tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. No, and you know what? We've got Bob Lombardi, Donnie Collins, the king.
I'd say, what, 5'10"?
We got a lot to squeeze in tomorrow.
I mean, the after show would be great. I always felt that that's where he excelled, the after show. Like, when I listen to Shikellamy football and, you know, and the Chiefs on there getting it done, Dave's just getting it done, getting it done. I always felt like on the after show, Soup kind of took it to another level. Didn't you think that?
Always.
We'll come back with more in a moment, brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
It's the Suit's home number. Let's go to Ken in Lewisburg. Ken, how are you? It's great to have you with us. Thanks for your patience.
Oh, not a problem. Thank you very much. I listen to your show quite a bit. I've never called in, but I had a question because you had talked about recruiting and signs and all of those things for Penn State and so forth. I wonder what your opinion was about why it is so difficult to get recruited for baseball in our area.
It's a great, you mean in terms of like really good players in the Valley or just recruiting in general?
In the Valley, and why would you have to spend thousands upon thousands of dollars in order to go to a school that only gives out 11 and a half scholarships or whatever it is for baseball? Make sense?
That's an excellent question, Ken, because you take somebody, for example, let's take Nick Dunn. All right, Nick Dunn out of Shikellamy. He went to Maryland, performed well at Maryland, ended up getting drafted by the Cardinals, and he's been trying to work his way up the Cardinals organization. The tough part is trying to get yourself recruited to play at a big-time program. If you can do that, then if you can get yourself, like Nick did, to the Cape Cod League, wooden bat, scouts all over the place. It's interesting that I think there are a lot of really, really good ball players in the Valley, just like there are a lot of really good ball players here. But over the years, I've felt that the limit on coaching staffs and also the limit on scouting has, especially in this era of analytics and video, I think you need to see players to really get a feel for how good they really are. And I'm wondering,
well, obviously
in today's,
I have a little bit of a personal thing to which has been taken care of, but I was just curious. But keep going.
I think the part of it is the ability to see somebody in person. There seems to be less and less over time. I don't know if you've found this, Ken. I mean, because I loved your perspective. That it seems like you're seeing people less and less because people are cutting back on the scouting part of it and using more of the analytics and video part of it.
Yeah, well, I have no problem saying my son was a 4-year starter at the quarterback at Lewisburg.
Wonderful.
And he's moved on to Davidson. He just moved in. And he'll be trying out for a roster spot to pitch at Davidson. But he had turned down a number of different things, but he wasn't highly recruited because of where we live. And we did not want to go to 1,000 different showcases. So that's why I was asking.
Well, can I tell you something that's encouraging, though? because of what my broadcasting job with the State College Spikes, you would have no, you have no idea, Ken, how many different. Now Davidson's a decent sized school, obviously, and you know if it's good enough for Stephen Curry, it's good enough for your child.
I would okay. say so. Yes.
Yeah. So, but the number of schools, and many you've never heard of, even NAIA schools, community colleges. That's one thing about baseball. If you're good, my experience over time in the last 14, 15 years of doing State College Spikes baseball, and this includes, you know, when they play Lowell, they play Staten Island, you know, whomever it may be, they'll find you. All he has to do is get himself a roster spot, Ken, and if he performs well, they'll find him. Because the schools I see, when they give me the list, I'll say, okay, now where is that? And I'm pretty well versed on where most worst colleges are. Until I start doing baseball, you're like, where in the heck is that? They found you.
Well, that's why I wanted your opinion. I mean, we passed up a number of, well, not we, he. But they were smaller, and they offered them football and baseball and all the other stuff. But I just don't understand the baseball recruiting process. And my other son wrestles at Lehigh, so it's not like I've not done this before.
Right, and there you're dealing with
curious.
There, yeah, there you're dealing with 9.9 scholarships, so you completely understand partials, fulls, you know, the way they put the the puzzle together. And baseball's the same kind of puzzle, so you're well versed in it.
Very much so, and I appreciate you taking the time to take my call.
No, and again, Ken, if the way Major League Baseball operates, with the number of guys I see get drafted from schools that many of us have never heard of, that's why I've always said, if you're good enough, Major League Baseball, to their credit, they find you. So if he gets in there and gets his shot and he does well enough, I'm telling you, somebody will find him because they're looking all the time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Excellent, excellent question. You know, there's and something Ken talked about there. He says, "Look, I didn't want to take my son to 1,000 showcases." Well, A, you have no idea how much I respect that. I do. I respect that because there are a lot of people that pour a lot of time into one showcase after another, and after a while, I hope Ken's son does great—not well, but does great at Davidson and gets noticed. Baseball is constantly looking for people. Constantly. My only problem with that would be the fewer minor league teams, which then might mean, obviously, fewer opportunities. We'll talk to you tomorrow with Donnie Collins.